Well, what is happening in Egypt is something of an immense importance, not only due to the importance of the country, but also due to the radicality of the demand. The demand is not just that Mubarak should leave, that is first step, but that the system should be changed, putting an end to the neoliberal system associated with the military dictatorship. And that is going to be, it's the start of a long series of battles for months and perhaps even more to come and to yet develop. The plan of the ruling system, and supported by the United States and of course by Europe behind the United States, is not to allow that, is that to make the minimal concession in order to safeguard the essential of the system, that is a capitalist neoliberal integration in the global system, which is at the root of all the social devastation, of course, but simultaneously a system which is aligned on the US policy for the at global level and for the region. That means also tolerating or allowing de facto Israel to continue the devastation in occupied Palestine. Now, this is their plan. It is what Obama means by a smooth transition, a transition which would lead to no change, in fact, except some minor concessions, such as that Mubarak personally would leave. That is what is on the agenda now, that the movement will continue to develop, to radicalize, and to be more and more demanding for more in-depth changes in the society, in the management of the political system through a truly democratic, respecting law system, but also a social and economic policy which is bound to come into conflict with the global capitalism. The movement is not that of Baradei. He's only one person among others, with no such big importance. The movement is led as usually in our times, by a series of small network organizations, small or less than small. But there are also social strong movements in Egypt. After all, some years ago, there were the strongest strikes that ever have been seen since 50 years on the whole continent of Africa, and leading to new pattern of trade unions which are really independent from the system, as opposed to the very conventional trade unions which are under the control of the government. There is also very strong peasant movement, because there is a process of exclusion of peasants by wealthier owners of land, and they are resisting. And all that is being more and more combined. Of course, there are political forces more or less organized. There is the left, in radical left in Egypt, including communists, who are not unimportant. And of course, there is the Muslim Brotherhood. But as you have seen, the Muslim Brotherhood was not coming into was not initiating the movement, but they jumped into the train when they saw that the movement was so large. They considered, rightly, unfortunately for themselves, that it would be silly to remain out. Now, the Muslim Brotherhood has a very reactionary leadership who has been against, who has been supporting the regime, opposite to what is being said often, by taking position against the trade unions and the strikes, against the peasant movement, with capitalism, with market law. Simultaneously, they have de facto accepted the leadership of the US globally and in the region, and de facto accepted also tolerating Israel to continue devastation of Palestine. These are the facts. But of course, as always, people who are of that type, they are demagogic, and they say something, but they do not do what they say. And in many, many cases, they do exactly the opposite of what they say. Now, it is obvious that in the plan of the US and of the ruling class of Egypt to manage a smooth transition leading to no change, they will be, or there will be attempt to integrate them more. But they are already integrated. The regime of Mubarak have given them enormous power in the society. It is the regime who gave them the three major institutions, the schools, education, justice, and the TV. It's enormous. And it is through the control by the Muslim Brotherhoods of education, justice, and the TV that things like the Islamic veil and so on have been not introduced but forced upon the Egyptian people. Neoliberalism is breaking down, is already in a complete obvious failure. That has started a number of years ago in Latin America, with people's movement being able to change to various degrees governments and move beyond, at least beyond the limitations of a neoliberal policy to various degrees. It was also initiated a number of years ago in Nepal, in Asia. Now it has moved to the North African continent, but it will move also to other parts of the South, in Latin America, in other parts of Africa, in other parts of Asia, for sure. Now, but all the advances which have been achieved, and there are advances achieved here and there, or movements in struggles which are achieving things, such as the one in Egypt, after the one in Tunisia, remain still very vulnerable. Very vulnerable because of a number of reasons. First, that imperialism and the imperialist triad, United States, Europe and Japan, have still in their hands a lot of means trying to interfere in those affairs by financial debt, etc., all by economic and financial means, and they use it. But beyond that, they have also political reactionary friends and supports, and also they can consider coup d'etat, military interventions. After all, they are already intervening in the region, in Iraq, in Afghanistan, and elsewhere. They could more. So, and vis-à-vis that enormous political challenge, the movements of the people remain, even if it is gigantic in some cases, as is the case in Egypt, millions and millions and millions of people demonstrating daily, and more than demonstrating, organizing themselves more and more, even that they are not yet at the level of the challenge, that they are not yet able to capture the power and to establish a new democratic popular alternative. First, Africa is not out of the global system. It is perfectly integrated as well as other regions. Second, it has been integrated until now in the most brutal way, which is at the root of the social disasters. For the present imperialist global system, Africa is important for its enormous natural resources, not only oil and gas, but land, but water, but also rare mineral resources and so on. But Africans are not important. They are rather an obstacle for the plundering of the natural resources of the Africa. This is the vision of the imperialist of Africa. Fortunately, the peoples exist in Africa. And even if until now, after all, Africa has been a partner in the Bandung period with Asia, in a first wave of awakening of the people, we have changed Africa more than any other continent in the 60s and in the 70s, whatever were the contradictions, limits, and even derivations of those systems. They have achieved a lot, and we are moving into a second wave. True, that second wave did not start in Africa. It started in Latin America and Asia in different ways, but it is moving, it has moved to, after all, the North African countries are African countries, and I'm sure that there will be an echo in many places. The World Social Forums are positive initiatives which have achieved already and which will continue achieved. I'm not pessimistic about that, but it is not exclusive. I mean, the main battles and struggles are not those only, exclusively, of those organizations and networks which are come to be represented in the social forums. They are in many cases outside. I mean, what happened in Latin America, what is happening now in Tunisia and Egypt, what will happen tomorrow more in other, also in other countries, is not limited to those networks of people who happen to be represented in the social forums.